Welcome to Sakarya in Turkey for the climax of the UCI BMX Supercross Series. This race will decide the winners of the World Cup titles for 2021. I'm Graham Bell. Joining me in the commentary box is Amy Fuller. Now, Amy, what were your highlights from yesterday's race?
Graham, now things are really heating up over here. Yesterday, it was all about the men's elite, a full Colombian sweep. Arboleda, Peluard and Ramirez all taking the top spots. A really magic day for Colombian BMX. And then in the women's, Laura's remarkable victory as she pipped Stansel to the post on the last straight.
Absolutely fantastic. Yes, now we've had our calculators out and these are the riders who are in the running to take the men's and women's elite titles. In the men's side, Carlos Ramirez sits on 625 points with Simon Markar just 35 points on 590 behind. Now it's 150 for a win all the way down to 70 points for an eighth place in the final. Vincent Peluard is in third, 83 points behind. So Peluard, if Ramirez to win, but Peluard, well, Peluard would have to win and Ramirez would have to not place in the final.
And let's not forget Joris Dode, another consistent rider to watch with a place in the final in round seven. He sat in the fourth spot and has the possibility to make the top three.
So it's still all open on the men's side, particularly between Ramirez and Marca. On the women's side, Mariana Pajon is sitting on 700 points. Natalia Afremova at 635 is 65 behind. Laura Smolder sits on 620, having not raced the two races in Colombia. She's on a roll, though, with back-to-back victories yesterday and the previous weekend in Sakarya. If Smolders were to win, she would move up onto 770 points, which means that if Pajon made the final but was last, say if she crashed, then they would be equal, tied on points, and it would go back to a countback on number of victories, which Smolders would win. So there we go. That is the maths of how it could pan out on the men's and women's elite side for the championship standings. But before we move on to that, we're going to get things underway with the men's under 23 competition. And in the first of the heats, we're going to basically focus on the Italians.
Riders ready, watch the gate.
Watch out for Marco Radielli, plate 647. And his teammate Leonardo Cantiero. And Cantiero has the lead.
And they are absolutely sailing into that second straight.
Yeah, Cantiero with the German Jonas Baalbach in second.
Holding nothing back in these early quarterfinal rounds. It really is all to play for, and it's tight.
Well, great move there by the Italian Radielli to move up into second place. Almost took the win away from his teammate Leonardo Cantiero. Let's get across the other pond and have a look at the replay. So let's have a look at the replay of this race. Marco Radielli, fresh from a win in the World Junior Championships in Papendal, was lying in third as he came down the second straight, but able to overtake the German and almost take his teammate there.
Close call.
So Cantiero, Radielli, Jonas Baalbach and Roy Kater of the Netherlands go through to the next round. There are six in these heats with top four going through. Watch out for Nakai Asuma.
Talk about total dominance, Graham, throughout this series. We've seen him grace the podium consistently.
But the two Italians, Pietro Bertagnoli, he's had some victories in Sakarya.
And they're off. An absolutely stacked heat.
Oh, this could be the final. This heat could be the final with Nakai and Bertaglioni. They've been fighting it out. They were fighting it out last weekend. They fought it out yesterday in the final.
And Nakai is not letting the Italian have it easy. Oh, Nakai just losing a place there, bumping down into third.
Yeah, Christian Castro coming through into second, riding for Ecuador. And Nakai, well, he's going to qualify through, but not with the gate choice that he would have wanted.
And we really have seen the effects of the importance of gate choice throughout these rounds. It seems it's either gate one or gate eight. Gate eight being a very interesting choice.
Difficult to ride around the outside on this track. Of course, no Nick Keeman in the men's elite competition. He's opted to sit this one out, the reigning Olympic champion. He is the master of the gate eight start. And Pietro Bertagnoli of Italy goes through with Christian Castro, Nakai Assuma in third, and the other Italian, Matteo Tugnolo.
That's really going to put the young Italian in premium position going ahead into the semi-finals.
As Matisse Callier goes off injured there, let's hope he's okay. In the third heat, we've got more Italy represented here with Giacomo Gargaglia. Watch out for Matteo Colsone, though, the Frenchman. Placed on the podium yesterday, Ina Lindberg. The Swede.
Ready. Watch the game.
And the Swiss, the long-haired Swiss, Noah Breschen. Breschen is in, well, it looks like he's going to go into about third or fourth. It's going to be a tight one between Gargaglia and Lindberg. Gargaglia out in front with the young Swede pressing in.
Just catching the transition there. Really using the apex of each turn here. You'll notice coming in low, coming high to take the speed out of the transition to ride it all the way home. What a race that one was.
Yeah, Giacomo Gargaglia comfortable there once he established the lead. Ina Lindberg, that's a good race for him. And Thibaut Stoffels and Noah Breschen are the qualifiers. Early days yet in this competition. Once you get to eight as well, we're six in these quarterfinals. Once we go through into the semi-finals, there'll be eight riders on the track and less room for error.
Up in the intensity. You can see, though, these riders are all on the absolute limit here, fighting for those season ender points.
So Gargaglia, Lindberg, Stoffels and Breschen are through, with Matteo Colsone missing out there. That's a little bit of a surprise, really, to see Colsone. So watch for Vanis Magdalenis wearing the sleeve of the national champion, Belgian national champion, with Martin Bogard, his teammate, lining up next to him.
Okay, riders, random start. Riders ready, watch the
also game. There's the two Belgians. We also have Casper Luis of Switzerland. Two riders from Ecuador, but it's the two Belgians that are out in front. And Magdalenis clearly out in front now of his teammate. It's Magdalenis, Bogart, the Swiss, Casper, and there must have been a crash there. I couldn't see it on the screen, I heard it.
Yeah, you could certainly hear that. Three riders leaving night and day between the rest of the pack.
Well, we heard the crash, we didn't see it, but there was definitely a coming together. The Belgians were clear and out in front, and it looked to be like the riders from Ecuador and the Dutch rider, Odin Verhoog, went down. We can see a different camera angle on this. But yeah, look at this, two Belgians.
You see just the sheer magnitude of this track. The rollers, the berms, it is huge. And you really, you're unaware of it until you actually stand on the track. The scale of it is immense.
Yeah, standing at the start is quite impressive. Vanessa Magdalena, she's been quick on this course with his teammate Martin Bogar. Luis Casper through, and those are your qualifiers. Now we're going to have a quick look back at yesterday's racing in the under 23 competitions, both on the men's and the women's side. In the first of the women's semi-finals. Now this is the elite. This isn't the under 23, this is the elite.
Laura Smulders. Absolutely dominating yesterday's performance right the way through from the semi-finals.
And her sister, Meryl Smulders, in the second of the semi-finals with a big crash there. Peyton Ridenour and Vaskova of Russia going down. Meryl Smulders with Zoe Klessens in second place.
Such dominance from the Smulders sisters on this circuit. It must be really special to have a sister traveling with you.
Well, in the final, it was all about Felicia Stansel. She got the whole shot. She got out in the lead. She looked like she was comfortably away, but Laura Smulders was not giving up on it and able to take the power all the way out of that last berm and over the rhythm section and takes her 22nd World Cup win and borrows her sister's jersey there for the podium in the men's competition. The semi-finals, the first of them, it was about the young Colombian, Diego Arboleda. He was flying.
He was on top form yesterday.
In the second of the semi-finals, Joris Dodé stamping his class on the field with Ross Cullen in second place at that point, but Cullen just getting pushed slightly wide on berm two. Dodé was away, and it was another Colombian, Carmona, who came through. So the Colombians were stacked in this final.
And then this is where we saw the victory, the Colombian sweep. Diego, Vincent, and Carlos all taking the top spots. An absolutely magic day for Colombian BMX.
Well, it was actually 1, 2, 3, and 4 in the end. Carlos Ramirez getting that third place to extend his lead in the elite standing. So that's how the men's and women's elite competition panned out yesterday. And we're going to move straight through to the men's elite competition. This is the quarterfinal stage that we'll pick it up in. In the first of these quarterfinals, watch out for yesterday's winner, Diego Arboleda. He's in gate one. And Arboleda is looking good again. Oh, a crash. Who was it went down there? We got Arboleda, PR Carmona. We might have lost Christian Kriegers, the Latvian.
Arboleda claiming that whole shot all the way from gate one, looking dominant into the last turn here. Can he hold on to it?
Well, Arthur PR looking comfortable in second place, but Arboleda is quick again today. 33.73. That is super fast.
I think that's what's so unique about this back-to-back race weekends. It really has allowed the riders to get acquainted with the track. So we're going to see some serious action unfold today in this final stop of the series.
Well, Arboleda won the final yesterday in a 33.32. So already to put down 33.73 in this round just shows the speed that he has.
And it's all about making the smart choice of line on the track to find the fastest possible route round. And if you're in gate one and you get out of that gate first, claim the whole shot, it really is yours to mark your line.
So check out that time, 33.73. Diego Arboleda, comfortable. Arthur Piart in second. Dylan Gobert of France in third. And the other Colombian, Matteo Carmona, qualifies in fourth. So watch out for Joris Daudet and the two Swiss, Cedric Bouty and Gilles Brunner. Daudet with the grey top and the blue helmet in gate three, riding plate 33. Watch for Dode.
Riders ready, watch the gate.
Dode powerfully out of the start. Will he get the lead going into the first berm? It's gonna be tight. Dode just pushed wide.
The power Dode in that second. Man's legs though.
Oh, it's really tight now. It's Matteo Bouty has moved into second place. Dode's in third. Ah, they are absolutely shoulder to shoulder, elbow to elbow. So they come on to the final straight. It's the plate 100 from Romain Mathieu, who takes the win. Cedric Bouty of Switzerland in second and Joris Dode in third. Well, I think, Amy, everyone was being quite careful there because there was some really close riding as they went around. No one wanted to take anyone else down. No one wanted to go down. And to ride around kind of in formation like that on that first berm was pretty impressive.
Yeah, some really close encounters there, especially on the first berm. Joris Daudet out in front on the 8-meter stargate. You could really just see the power and aggression as the blocks dropped. But it is all about line choice, and we saw Daudet just getting bumped off the side of the corner.
Well, that's the difference between going in gate three and going in gate one. Now watch out for the Colombian Vincent Pelluar in this third heat. Renaud Blanc of Switzerland is in gate one with Pelluar in gate two. They're off, they're running. Pelluar looking really, really fast and able to move from gate two into the lead as he goes round the first berm. It's Pelluar with Rago Richard of France in second. Renaud Blanc dropped down into third place.
Oh, and the Swiss rider actually looking behind him there.
Well, it's just a quick check over his shoulder to check that the door was still open going into that second berm. But look at Pelluar go. The Colombians are really flying. What time will Pelluar get here? This is what it's about. Pushes the bike across the line, 34.08. Not quite as quick as his teammate Arboleda, but still very impressive from Vincent Pelluar.
Colombian dominance strikes again.
Yeah, they really do have the measure of this.
There we go, a quick peep behind the Swiss rider. And a solid finish there from the Colombian, sealing the deal on his semi-finals debut.
Yeah, so Vincent Pelluar is through. Renaud Blanc in second, but the two French, Mathis Rago-Richard and Corentin Dubois. Giacomo Fantoni, unfortunately, not making it through to the semi-finals. Now, this is all about Simon Marquardt. He is in the running for the series title, and he is in gate two. On his inside there is Eddie Clerte of France. We also have Julian Schmidt, Ross Cullen in this, Carlos Ramirez. Now, Ramirez is not wearing the brightly coloured trousers he was wearing yesterday. He was wearing those really loud yellow trousers.
And Simon Marquardt takes the whole shot around the first berm.
Marquardt out in front. Ramirez and Clerte battling it out. Ramirez just had the inside line on that corner. Has moved ahead of the Frenchman. Simon Marquardt. These are the two that are battling it out for the season's title. And Marquardt, wow, he's stamping his authority on that one. But
what
if Ramirez can continue to shadow him, there's 35 points between those two riders.
What a race that was, Graham.
Yes.
Simon Marquardt really out here and hungry for those points. We've seen him riding so consistently throughout this series, just making the finals yesterday and falling short of the podium. He certainly's got a point to prove today.
Well, the problem that Simon Marquardt has is that he could potentially be up against a team of Colombians in the final, and team tactics might come into play. Ross Cullen just missing out there, fifth place for the British rider.
So good to see Ross Cullen out here, though, in the quarterfinals in round 7 and 8. You'd take that, wouldn't you?
Yeah, good stuff. And following in the footsteps of Kai White, who will be back racing next season. We're going to have a quick look back, though, at the under-23 competition from yesterday. And in the first of the semi-finals, it was Vineta Peterson of Latvia who took the win over Yabuta Yui of Japan. In the second semi-final, Léa Branonge of France took the win over Akio Gomez of Belgium. And that set things up quite nicely for the final. Peterson going from that gate number 8 was not able this time to ride around the outside of Yabuta Yui. And the Japanese holding off the Latvian. Peterson, who's dropped down from elite level to race in under 23 in this stop of the tour, gets on the podium. But it is Yabuta Yui that took the win. In the men's competition, in the first of the semi-finals, it was all about the Italian Pietro Bertoloni.
Making his mark right the way through the rounds, very consistent throughout this whole weekend.
In the second semi-final, the series leader, Nakai Asuma from Japan, had the whole shot. And when Nakai can get out in front, he is virtually unstoppable. But in the final, it was that man, Pietro Bertagnoli, who had to defend Nakai. I thought that Nakai could just get past here. He had the inside line coming out of berm 1, but then going into the second corner, and going down that second straight, Bertagnoli able to extend his lead just enough and held off a late charge by Matteo Colsone.
What a spectacular new addition to the programme for UCI this year. A great way to support this next generation of talent from junior right the way through to elite.
So we're going to have a look at the semi-finals of the women's under 23 competition. So there is Yabuta Yui, yesterday's winner. But didn't get a good start there. Léa Branonge of France is in the lead with Eberhardt of Switzerland in second. Yabuta Yui is in third. And it is Branonge.
Yesterday's third place winner. Looking to get herself up onto that podium again today.
She's really improved as the season has gone on, has Léa Branonge. Eberhardt just pressing her to the line. And Yabuta Yui with her fellow Japanese rider, Nishimura Naneka, coming through in fourth place.
And they are off.
It's a poor start there from Yabuta Yui.
This is the second straight here where we see the men and women split. Very technical double section there, close together. Very steep as well. If you make a mistake in this section, it will cost you.
So confirmation of the qualifiers from the first of the semi-finals. We're going to roll on to the second of the semi-finals.
A little bit of track grooming going on there. Perfect conditions for these riders today.
Well, watch out for Talia Burford. She's leading the individual standings comfortably. 855 points. She started the season off so well. One in Verona, one twice in Colombia. She's had a second place on this track. So Burford is there, as far as I can see. She wasn't listed on the graphic, but Talia Burford is there. Also, Vanetta Peterson is lined up in gate 8, 212, her plate number. And if you're into Squid Games, you'll probably remember 212 in Squid Game. Vanetta Peterson making a move around the outside, and this is a cycling version. Peterson unable to get ahead of Burford.
Burford really showing us why she is the current leader. Smooth and consistent, smart choice of line. But Vanetta Peterson is on her tail, and she's pushing. But it is the young Swiss rider that claims victory.
And Peterson didn't really need to attack that much the line because she knows she's going to go for gate 8 no matter what. So I think keeping some of the energy, the ATP still in the muscles to get that quick firing power.
Yeah, this sport really is all about power. Each run lasting between 30 to 45 seconds. It really is pure lactic acid. The riders have got to be strong, aggressive, and most importantly, powerful. Also, with these back-to-back race weekends, it is all about the body's ability to recover, to race back-to-back. Very taxing physically and mentally as well.
Absolutely. So as we check the track, we'll get things ready to move on to the next round. And it's the men's under 23 competition. Oh, it's going to be tough, this one. Tough job for Asuma Nakai.
Yeah, this heat is absolutely stacked.
It certainly is. So Vanis Magdalenis, the Belgian national champion, watch out for him. Watch out for Nakai Asuma. That's the Swiss, Luis Casper. So Nakai in gate 4, right in the middle with Vanis Magdalenis in gate 1. And it is Magdalenis, and it looks like it could be, wow, great move from Christian Castro. But it is the Belgium and the Japanese that are out in first and second.
What a move by Nakai there on that first corner. Really looking to seal the deal and make his mark on this track. Can he hold on?
Well, Magdalenis looks like he's going to take the win, and does. Nakai's in second. And a big move there from the Ecuadorian rider, Pedro Benzelkar. And it was the Italian Leonardo Cantiero that went through in fourth. So it was a real battle there for that fourth place spot on the final straight. Vanis Magdalenis got out in front and was able to hold off Nakai Asuma. But look at the battle for third, fourth, and fifth as we go around this final burn. It was neck and neck.
Nakai's got to be happy with that result after a relatively average weekend for him in comparison to the rest of the season.
Well, he set him up nicely for the finals. He's not the best. He's not going to have the first choice of gate, though, with Vanis Magdalenis just ahead of him on time, 34.05. So time is important, particularly when you get to the semi-final stage. Second heat of these semi-finals is looking pretty stacked towards Italy. We've got Pietro Bertagnoli, who won yesterday, Marco Radielli, the world junior champion, Giacomo Gargaglia. There's two Belgians involved as well, Theobald Stoffels and Martin Bogart. But I think you've got to look at 6-2-2. Pietro Bertagnoli
really stomping his authority on this race weekend. Consistency throughout.
Be interesting to see what Noah Breschen can do. He has the speed out of the start. So, Pietro Bertagnoli, 6-2-2, is actually in gate three. And they're off, they're underway. Oh, great start from both of the Italians. And Gargaglia has done enough to keep out his team. Oh, there's a crash. Oh, I thought there was going to be a crash. Well, Bertagnoli's got some serious work to do now. He's way back in last place. It's Gargaglia, Breschen, Bogart, Radielli. Bertagnoli's trying to make it back up and into the race, into the running. Did so well to stay on his bike. Can he make his way back through? Gargaglia. Gargaglia's going to do it. Oh, no, Bertagnoli is not going to do it. Seventh place for yesterday's winner. And it all came down to that survival move on the first turn.
Yeah, definitely played the game there. It is all about survival. Not going down in that first corner. He just clung on.
But just lost all of his speed and momentum. Look at the two Italians coming in with Noah Breschen coming in from around the outside. But it was that shoulder-to-shoulder move. It was Bogart against Bertagnoli. And Bertagnoli coming off the worst in that encounter.
That is just an example. If you're new to BMX, welcome. It's fast, it's reactive, aggressive, and anything can happen. So we saw yesterday's race winner just get bumped to the back of the pack.
Well, he was lucky to stay actually on the track there.
On two wheels, yeah. Too right.
So qualification for Gargaglia, Breschen, Bogart, and Radielli. Well, we're going to move on to the semi-finals of the women's elite competition next.
Now, I'm excited about this, Graham. It is all to play for in the points game. Everyone here is riding on the limit, looking to seal the deal on a place in that finals.
Yeah, Yeah, just looking at the standings, Mariana Pajon, 700 points. Natalia Afremova, 635. Laura Smulders, 620. Remember, it's 150 for the win, 130 for second, 115 for third, all the way down to 70 points for the eighth place position. Pajon knows that if she can qualify through to the final, then all she has to do is not be last, and she will be crowned the series winner. Well, just making sure that we're running absolutely on time and on schedule. In the first of this semi-finals, Meryl Smulders is in there with Pajon.
An absolutely stacked heat, just prepping the track, ready for the girls' semi-finals. Things really are heating up.
There's the VIPs.
Wouldn't mind claiming myself a little spot in there for a bit of race viewing. I wonder what's on the menu today.
Great atmosphere in the crowd. And they are in for a treat. And it is great to see BMX being pushed out and around the world by the UCI. This is a new stop on the tour. So here we go with the Women's Elite semi-finals. This is heat one. Watch out for Mariana Pajon. She's leading the standings. Meryl Smulders with plate 22.
There's Molly Simpson,
young Canadian.
Fresh up and really making her mark in this elite category.
Yeah, Simpson's been riding quickly. She's been riding well here on this track. There's another Canadian in there as well.
And there she is, Tegan Pascal, queen of BMX. Can she do it? Can she seal the deal on a place in the finals?
Well, before we get to that, as is tradition in this part of the world, we're going to have a call to prayer. We are right next to the mosque here in Sakarya. And we're going to have a quick delay while we have the call to prayer. And it's only right that we respect the local cultures of Turkey.
Call to prayer happening five times daily here in this part of the world.
Yeah, so while we do that, while we have the call to prayer, just like have a think back about the season as a whole, the races that we've been to. We started off in Verona in Italy, 8th and 9th of May. It was kind of all about the Swiss there, wasn't it, on the men's side?
Yeah,
Simon Marker announcing himself. They went back-to-back wins, didn't they? David Graf taking a win on the second day, and Simon Marker winning on the first day. David Graf has since retired, competed in his last race at the World Championships in Papendal, got a third place, bronze medal in Papendal, and then hung up the bike, and will now be taking up a position in coaching.
That's certainly a great way to leave the sport, making your mark. What a great season he's had, really just clinging on there for that extra year. Tokyo being pushed back to 2021.
Back in Verona, Laura Smulders took a win. Judy Bohr, it was Netherlands back-to-back. And then we moved on to Colombia, and Mariana Pajon won both of the races there on her home track. She's actually from Medellin, but living in Colombia now. And in the men's competition in Colombia, it was Joris Dode that won both of those races there as well. And then we moved to Turkey a week ago. Simon Marka won the first. Carlos Ramirez took his maiden World Cup victory last weekend on the men's side. And yesterday, Diego Arboleda took a maiden victory as well for Colombia. And on the women's side, well, in Sakarya in Turkey, Felicia Stansel won for the first time. Then it's all been about Laura Smulders. And interestingly, it's been Stansel leading on both occasions, and Laura Smulders has been able to ride past her on that finish straight. So we've had three races on this track in Sakarya, and Stansel has been leading going into the final corner on all three of them. But
it's crazy. That really is a long last straight with a massive sprint to the finish. And it is where we are seeing places won and lost, and Laura Smulders certainly making her mark on that last bit of the track.
So here we go. Series leader, plate 100, Mariana Pajon. She won the Olympic gold in London 2012. She defended that Olympic title in Rio, took gold in Rio, silver medal behind Britain's Beth Shriver in Tokyo this season. She is the queen of BMX, and she's heading towards Paris in 3 years' time. And can she make it four Olympic medals? Well, it's a long way between now and Paris, but this is the first stop. And Mariana Pajon, good start from the Colombian. And is that Molly Simpson? Great start from the Canadian. Simpson's probably going to end up in second here as they come around the first berm.
Mariana just defending her line.
Mariana Pajon looking very comfortable indeed. Molly Simpson just in her slipstream, watching the very best in the world and learning from her.
Molly Simpson holding nothing back though, attacking into this last straight. Oh, and it's close.
Well, Meryl Smulders is going to miss out here. Meryl Smulders missing out on a place in the final. And that was a bit of a surprise. I think it went wrong for Meryl Smulders on the first turn. If we have a look back at the replay, watch for the plate 22. So we saw Mariana Pajon come through with Simpson, and there was a problem there for Smulders, I think, just at the back of the pack.
Such a shame to not see her in the finals. Just magic, though, seeing two sisters out here in the game. Certainly a sense of Smulders' domination.
So Mariana Pajon is through, job almost done. If she can make the final and place better than eighth, then she is guaranteed the series title. So Laura Smulders, the older of the two Smulders sisters, is going up against Felicia Stansel. Stansel has been incredibly fast, has got the whole shot in the final.
It's been a real battle this weekend between Smulders and Stansel.
So Stansel in gate three. Natalia Suvorova in gate two, Smulders in lane one, and it's Smulders against Stansel. Stansel, she doesn't quite have enough of a lead here to take the lead going out of the first turn. That's how much the advantage of being on the inside of the track. Laura Smulders leads, Felicia Stansel in second place. In third place, it's Suvorova. Peyton Rowden now showing us that she's okay after a crash yesterday. In fourth place.
And Smulders really just in a league of her own, sailing down this last straight.
And Smulders, Stansel, always a real battle there for the fourth place. Right now, just missing out. And it looked like it was Natalia Suvorova and Hatakeyama in third and fourth. So we see the replay there. Felicia Stansel, well, she's started so well, but just not quite enough speed there to come from the gate three there to move into the lead.
and all the stars just aligning here for Laura Smulders, claiming her place in the final. Can she pip it to the top spot, Graham, on this overall series?
And interestingly, Smulders' time there of 37.23 is quicker than Mariana Pajon's time of 37.74. So Smulders will get the choice, the first choice of gate, and will probably pick gate one going into the final. But with Mariana Pajon, just all she needs to do is shadow Smulders to take the title. So the semi-finals of the men's elite competition. Wow. Look out for Diego Arboleda, yesterday's winner.
An absolutely stacked heat for the men.
And stacked with Colombians. We've got Ramirez, Peluar, Arboleda, Simon Marca. This could be the final. Look at them all. Three Colombians, one Swiss. Oh, there's a crash. Who was that? Which I think that was Ramirez that went down. The series leader is out. Oh, drama. Absolute drama. As Arboleda is comfortably ahead. Simon Marca is in second place. Oh, this could open up the whole of the title. Oh. Arboleda is going to take the win here. Simon Marca in second. But wow. It looked to me.
And drama unfolds again on the last straight. Man down.
So it was all about the very first jump. And there he is. Carlos Ramirez, the little magician, 2.78. Went down hard. He leaves the title. Wow, that's opened it up for Simon Marca. It really has. Only 35 points. That was what happened.
Absolutely brutal. Didn't even make it down the start ramp.
Wow. Such a shame.
Just shows the aggression going into it. Absolutely everything on the line. The riders riding absolutely on the limit.
It was Magnus Dira there stacking it on the final straight. But big, big drama. Oh, what a disappointment for Carlos Ramirez. He's such a gentleman, such a nice guy on the tour. And to not make the final, he has opened the door up to Simon Marca. 35 points difference between Marca and Ramirez. If Marca can score points in the final, then Marca will take the title. Well, that's not how we wanted it to be decided, really, but it's BMX, so often decided by a crash. Watch out for Joris Dode. Now, with Ramirez down and not making the final, it opens the door up for Peluar. Dode is 100 points behind Ramirez. It's 150 for a win, remember.
Riders ready, watch the gate.
Dode there in gate 7 has got some work to do. Needs to be really super fast. It looks like it's Eddie Clerte that's going to take the lead as they go around the first turn. It's teammate Dode in second. The Swiss Blanc fighting it out against Pierre of France.
Dode looking very comfortable in that second spot, really working the bike through this third straight.
But great moves from Clerte. Good ride from Eddie Clerte. Dode safely through. And it's Pierre and Blanc in third and fourth.
You could just feel the energy and intensity coming off the track.
Yeah, it was great riding there from the young Frenchman. He had an injury this year and he looks now to be fully recovered from that.
It's
So we see the photo finish. And Eddie Clerté, Joris Daudet, Arthur Piarts, France 1, 2, and 3. The Carmona of Colombia missing out to Renaud Blanc.
Six French in this semi-finals. Real strength and depth within that French team. Three clear, very dominant nations. Colombia with the clean sweep yesterday. France and, of course, Switzerland.
So the commissaire is just checking, comparing notes. Yeah, I'm just trying to work out the points here. Ramirez will probably end up in 16th position with 50 points. So Daudet, if Daudet can get onto the podium, Daudet has a chance. But then Marquardt, he's got the best chance. It's opened up the door for the Swiss to win the title here.
It certainly has. It really is all to play for as we enter the final rounds.
So we're going to start with the women's under 23 final coming up very shortly. And that's the lineup. Well, Talia Burford of Switzerland is comfortably in the lead in the series. There is her teammate, Nadine Eberhardt. She has taken gate 8. And 2-1-2 is Vineta Peterson of Latvia. Coming in also from the outside.
She loves that outside lane.
Trying to make it work. And from India, Amelia
Indonesia.
Sifa. Sorry, Indonesia. My apologies. Zoe Hapka of France.
Good to see the sport attracting people from all over the world.
And there's two Japanese in this. Nishimura Neneka and her teammate Yabuta Yui, yesterday's winner.
She's been so consistent throughout these rounds here in Turkey.
There is the series leader, Talia Burford. A look of concentration on her face. She wants to finish on a high note. And Leah Brendange of France has finished strongly with three third place finishes. So here we go. This is the final of the women's under 23 competition. Watch out for Vineta Peterson from lane 7. She got the speed to move from the outside into the lead. It's going to be really tight. Peterson has not quite done enough. She's in second, going down the second straight with the French rider Brandonge in first.
It is tight. It's neck and neck for third and fourth place. Buford just moving out.
Well, this could be a maiden victory in the under 23 competition for Leah Brandon. She's had four third place finishes.
Peterson chasing her down.
Peterson making a move on her, but not enough. And yes, great riding from the young French rider, Leah Brandon. She's done so well. She's been so consistent, placed on the podium on 4 occasions, and now she's on top of the podium. Well, let's have a look at the replay on that. Vineta Peterson opting to come from that lane seven on the outside. Couldn't quite get enough speed down the first straight to get ahead of the French rider from gate one.
Really an interesting move there, choosing that gate, but holding a very clean line and attacking there on this final straight, taking second place.
So confirmation of the final race of the season. Talia Burford finishing in third and wrapping up the series with the win. Vinetta Peterson in second place and Leah Brandonche taking her maiden victory. I think we're going to be able to move down to trackside to hear from the podium. Here from first, second and third, and we'll start off with Talia Burford. So Talia Burford coming into this clearly ahead in the standings. And Talia Burford is down with the track interviewer now.
A fantastic final race, Talia. You must be very, very happy to get another podium in Turkey.
Yeah, I'm very happy to take the third place today after a difficult day yesterday. It was not my day, but today I was on form and go on the podium. It's just perfect for me.
Well, a fantastic end to the season. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well done.
Well, she had a first and second in Verona. She won back-to-back in Colombia. She had a second here in the first weekend of racing, the rainy day on the Sunday. But we're going to have a look, and we're going to throw down to the interviewer in the finish, Gary, and we've got Vinetta Peterson, second place.
Vinetta, another phenomenal performance for you. Back on the podium in Turkey, you must be exceptionally happy.
Really happy. Really enjoyed racing, so nice to be on the podium. Really fun.
Talk us through the race. How did it go for you?
So I end up with only four pick, the gate pick, so someone decided to take my lane eight. Still went for seven. Had a really nice gate. Did not entirely close the inside coming into the first straight, so into the first turn. So that was that. Just tried to keep my position and see if I can find a spot to pass, which did not happen, but I'm still really happy.
Well, a second podium in 2 days, that's got to be good. Congratulations, well done.
Yeah, legs definitely feel that. Thank you.
Well, Vinetta Peterson will be able to have some time off and then start preparing for next season. So now we're going to line up the winner, Leah Brandonche. Well, she's been on the podium on numerous occasions, but this is her first win in the under-23s.
Leah, a fourth podium here in Turkey and finally on the top step. You must be very, very happy with your performance today.
Yeah, I'm very, very happy about this. Finish with a win, it's very cool.
And what was it about the race that you just did so well today above the other days that made you get first position?
Yeah, I good start, and yeah, in the track I'm faster. It's good.
Well, congratulations, very well done.
Thank you.
Well, Leah Brandonche just proving how important it is to ride fast in the semi-finals and get that first choice of gate. But you've got to be in it to win it, and she made the most of that lane one position. So time now for the men's under 23 final.
This one's gonna be interesting.
But before that, of course, we have the flower ceremony. And they do produce a good bunch of flowers here in Turkey.
Second place to Latvia, Veronika Petersen. And first place today, she gets on the top step this weekend from France. It is Lia Bouillon.
So congratulations to our podium in the women's under 23 competition. So there are the standings. Talia Burford, well, Leah Brandosch making a last minute attack, but it was Talia Burford going into this weekend that had such a lead that she couldn't be caught. But third place today, she's finished the season on a high after starting so well at the beginning in Verona and in Colombia.
You can give her the trophy and then here's the trophy.
And we're going to present Talia Burford with the trophy for the...
She really has a remarkable season. Making her mark on this under 23 category. What a fantastic concept, Graham.
Yeah, the first ever women's under 23 World Cup Supercross winner. So going into this final, Nakai Asuma is comfortably ahead, 200 points ahead of Christian Castro of Ecuador.
He really is the one to watch. Complete consistency throughout the season, and that's what it's going to take to claim that overall victory today.
Yeah, Vanis Magdalena, she's also on 620 points, so 200 points behind, so 100 with 150 points for a win. Nakai Asuma is guaranteed the title. The question is, who is going to finish with the win? Plate 600, Martin Bogart is in gate 7. We just saw Marco Radielli, the world junior champion. He's in lane 8. Noah Breschen with the curly locks coming out from under his helmet. The Swiss rider. Leonardo Cantiero of Italy. The Italians looking so strong, of course. No Bertoloni in this final. Crashed. Well, didn't quite crash out, but didn't qualify through. Pedro Bernal Cesar. Giacomo Gargaglia of Italy.
Real Italian dominance from this under 23 category.
Now Nakai Asuma will want to finish with a win. But Vanis Magdalens of Belgium in gate 1, the Belgium champion. Watch for the Italians. Three Italians in this with the Belgium in gate 1. Could be quick, but Nakai is super fast out of the blocks, and Nakai is going to take the lead going into the first berm. Nakai doing what he did in Colombia and leading from the front.
Into the second straight, absolute domination from the young Japanese man. He came out here
big crash.
To make his mark.
Cantiero went down. Cantiero of Italy went down. And that's given it to Nakai Asuma. Well, he was comfortably leading the standings going into this race, but he wanted to finish on a high, and he's done just that. And Giacomo Gargaglia in second. And who was it went down? Was that... Yes, it was Cantiero, I think, went down. Leonardo Cantiero. He's up and his...
Looks like he's ripped his trousers.
Yeah, his trousers have taken the majority of that.
Just shows the importance of wearing protective gear in this sport. Good to see he's up, riding and okay. Shame to see the Italian go down.
But let's have a look at the replay, and it was all about the start of the Japanese rider, Nakai Asuma. He was so strong in the stops in Colombia, and he was able to finally reproduce on the fourth time of asking in a final that performance again. That was the crash from Leonardo Cantiero. And that really opened up the door for his teammate Giacomo Gargaglia to come around.
Such an aggressive, dominant start from the Japanese, sealing his victory here.
And Martin Bogart of Belgium taking the third place. An applause for Leonardo Cantiero as he crosses the line. But there's the top three, Nakai, Gargaglia, Bogart, and Nakai, well, finishing on a high. What a way to win the first men's under 23 World Cup title. We're going to go down to Garriott trackside for the interview with the third place finisher, Martin Bogart. It'll be interesting to see what his take is on that exciting final.
Martin, a phenomenal race there. What happened on turn two? How dangerous was that?
Yeah. It was very close. I was making a move on the guy in front of me, and then suddenly, when my move was done, the guy crashed. I was like, oh no, I'm gonna ride in him. But then, yeah, I just went past him, luckily, so it was a close race.
It was a very close race, but to get a podium and third place in the final race of this series, you've got to be very happy.
Yeah, I'm very happy, really. Couldn't be more grateful.
Well, congratulations, very well
Can
done.
Can I say one more thing?
Of course.
Yeah, it's to my mother at home. And bedankt aan de mama. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, that's nice. Thanking his mum at home.
Just love the smiles and energy from that guy. He exudes it.
And we're going to second place. The second place finisher, Giacomo Gargaglia, is down at trackside.
Giacomo, a phenomenal race there. And as we just saw with Martin, a very tricky second corner. You must be very happy.
Yeah, I'm so happy after my crash last weekend. And all the week was so hard. Tried to recover fast. Finally, I'm here. I was on the final, and that's amazing. Track is cool, but it's so tight. So it's always a war in every place on the track. But it's cool to be here for the first time in Turkey. And it's amazing.
And you must be exceptionally happy to be on that podium, the final podium of the year.
Yeah, yeah. Finally, I closed my season with a good result after a hard season. But I'm so happy. I want to thank all the national team. This year is so fast, Italian team. And it's always so beautiful coming here to the race. I want to thank my coach, everyone, my family. It's so cool.
Well, congratulations. Very well done, my friend.
Thank you.
Oh, nice interview there from Giacomo.
Nice to see him. Yeah. Thanking family, friends, supporters, and just the sheer elation of being on top of that podium. What a result.
Well, there was only one man that had the series, and that was Nakai Asuma. And we're going to get to hear from the winner of this race and the winner of the series.
Asuma, finally you're on the top of the podium this week. How does it feel to be there on the last race of the series?
Finally, I'm so happy that I win this last one. There was so much pressure for me leading the standings and everything. So I really want to do this last one, ended up with winning, so I'm so happy. Yeah.
And just tell us, how does it feel to be the world champion?
You know, it's amazing. I've never experienced this feeling, so. It's just amazing, and I just be grateful for everyone who supported me, like family, coach, and friends, and sponsors, everyone. I'm so grateful.
Well, congratulations. It's thoroughly deserved. Well done.
Thank you very much.
Well, well done to Nakai Asuma. A really well-deserved win there. to seal his title victory, the first men's under 23 World Cup title winner.
The style, consistency and dominance throughout this series.
And I wonder how many of these podium we'll see riding in the elite next season, or whether they will, depends on their age. I need to check on the age of Nakai Asuma, if he has another year in under 23 or if he needs to move up. But congratulations to the podium.
Born in 2000, Asuma Nakai.
So I think that might be, yeah. So he's moving up next year, isn't he? No, you got one
no,
more year.
No, he's got another year. Another year in the camp. But with that depth of experience of, you know, taking the world title, maybe he'll make that jump.
Or maybe he'll want to come back and defend his under 23 title.
Interesting one, because the Olympic qualifications are coming around quick with the delay of Tokyo 2020 happening in 21.
Yeah, wasn't it 1,000 days to go just last week for Paris?
Yeah, unbelievable.
100 days to go to Beijing, 1,000 days to go to Paris.
The countdown is well and truly on.
So here we go, they're lining up for the final of the women's competition, the women's elite. And so often Laura Smulders is up in a battle with Mariana Pajón. Those two have been battling it out since London 2012. Smulders took the bronze medal in that Olympics. Pajón took the win. Plate 91, Elke van Hoof of Belgium. Eliska Bartunkova of the Czech Republic. Molly Simpson. She's really found some speed here in Turkey.
Making her mark on this track, consistent throughout the four races.
So Felicia Stansel, can she produce another fantastically fast hole shot like she has done in the previous finals and get out in the lead on the turn one? Hatakeyama Saya of Japan. And Natalia Suvorova in gate three from Russia. So Mariana Pajón, series leader, Olympic silver medalist. And yesterday's winner, Laura Smulders. 22 World Cup victories to her name, the most, more than any other female rider. So, Smulders, Pajón, watch for Stansel. Plate 23. They're off, they're running. Smulders look to have a good start. She's just got a half a wheel length ahead, but Stansel, here it is again. Stansel, a fantastic hole shot, and Stansel's in the lead with Smulders chasing her down. It's a repeat of yesterday. Mariana Pajón in third, that's enough to win her the title if she can stay on her bike. Stansel around the second berm, but Smulders, will she do the same again?
She is hot on her tail. Can Laura Smulders pick Stansel on that last straight?
Here we go.
This is nigh on a reactment of yesterday. Can she hold on, Stansel?
Come on, Felicia, come on, come on, Stansel. Oh no, she's done
and
it again.
It was neck and neck, but Smulders takes the win again. Back-to-back victories here in Turkey.
Oh, well, Felicia Stansel did much better than yesterday, but Smulders came through again. Mariana Pajón finishing in third there and guaranteeing the title victory. But it was all about Felicia Stansel's fantastically fast hole shot coming all the way from gate four. around the outside of the best BMX riders in the world.
She did say she'd been working on her starts, and it is so evident, the power on this woman. But then again, it comes down to tactics, and this is where Laura Smulders really does excel on this last straight, working the bike for every single inch.
And it was just Smulders who was able to take the win again over Stansel.
Down to the wire, and that really is what BMX is all about.
So Smulders takes her 23rd World Cup win. Wow, back-to-back weekends won by Laura Smulders. Felicia Stansel, well, she did her best there. It wasn't much in it. And Mariana Pajon is going to win the World Cup series with that third place finish here today. And we're going to be able to hear, I hope, from Mariana Pajon first. And we'll talk about the way that this race panned out. It'd be interesting to hear her thoughts about the road to Paris as well, and whether she is going to continue, and I think she is, all the way to the next Olympic Games in 3 years' time in Paris. But yeah, they're congratulating each other, and we're going to try and get them down for an interview as soon as possible. But yeah, that was quite an incredible race.
I think that's the thing that's so special about extreme sports. There really is a lot of respect among the peers. You could see them congratulating each other there. You know, it is fast, it is dangerous, it is reactive. And that's where that real level of sportsmanship comes in, and respect, which is so nice to see.
Because there are injuries into this sport, and Mariana Pajon had that knee injury back in 2018. Tore her ACL, broke her tibial plateau. She's back on the bike in 2019 and fought her way back into the top. So I think we've got Mariana with Gary now. Let's go down to trackside.
Mariana, a fantastic performance in the final there, another podium. Just how happy a lady are you?
I'm super happy. I thought like I was coming to Turkey just for vacation, so I ended up really good. I ended up with the overall, so yeah, for sure I'm happy.
And what about the actual race in the final? Was it a tactical one? Did you want to stay out of trouble? What was going through your mind?
I love to win. I really wanted to win. Had a good gate. Larry's super fast, and Felicia too. They did a good job. I gave it all.
Well, congratulations and very well done.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Big smiles from Mariana Pajon. She thought she was coming on to Turkey on vacation. Well,
I mean, Mariana Pajon going to race BMX on vacation. That just doesn't happen. She is always in the mix. Yeah.
So I think we're going to be able to hear from the second place finisher, Felicia Stansel. It's a three-peat for her. She won the first race here last weekend in Turkey, but it's been three second places since then. So we have Felicia Stansel now.
Felicia, a phenomenal performance there. You tried so hard right until the end, and then we're just pipped again on the line. I can see you're not too happy about that.
Yeah, I tried to like always learn from my mistakes, but I watched a lot of video last night, and I don't think I was slow because I like kept the same gap between like the third and fourth riders, but her last straight is really good, so just something I need to work on eventually.
But I can see the camaraderie amongst the ranks. She was joking with you there, stealing your jersey. It's nice to be amongst friends as well as competitors.
Oh yeah, we're buddies. We're good buddies. We're gonna start training for grands in about like 10 minutes.
Well, congratulations on all the hard work this season. A phenomenal performance. Very well done.
Thank you.
It's nice to hear from Felicia Stansel. Always a smile on her face. And she has got the fastest start in the world right now. Incredible hole shot from her.
Absolutely untouchable down that first start ramp. The power in the legs.
but it was Laura Smulders. She's done it again. 23 World Cup wins. And she wanted Stansil's top because it's number 23.
Laura, another fantastic win and a close call at the end, but again you're on top. How do you feel?
Oh, great. Couldn't be better. It's been a long 2 weeks here in Turkey. Had a lot of fun and racing was really good with all the girls. Very tired actually. We didn't do that many laps, but I guess it's big days like these mentally and physically. So, well, we pulled it off at the end again. I had a pretty good gate this time, but Felicia was just a little bit faster again on the first straight. So went for the same game plan, wait for my turn and did it again on the last straight, had more speed. So very, very happy.
And what is it that you're so quick at on that last straight? You seem to just breeze past people.
I mean, riding in front is very hard. I really like the chasing part of it. Somehow it gives a little bit more energy having someone in front of you to chase down. Your legs kind of don't feel that sore, but after the finish line you still feel it. But somehow I just keep it smooth and try to be relaxed on the track, don't make any mistakes, so I keep my speed. And then just pedal very hard over the last turn.
Well, a phenomenal performance and yet another top of the podium performance. Very well done.
Thank you.
So 23 World Cup victories for Laura Smulders. And she is after that top of Felicia Stansil. Stansil riding with the number 23. And Smulders riding her down again on the finish straight. So, time now for the flower ceremony. So, congratulations, Laura Smulders, Felicia Stansil, and Mariana Pajon. And there are the standings. Mariana wins over Smulders, and Felicia Stansil in third place in the series.
Remarkable seeing Smulders bump up into that second spot after this phenomenal weekend of back-to-back racing.
Of course, Smulders missed out on the two races in Colombia that Mariana won back-to-back weekends, so the fact that Smulders is so close is quite incredible.
Yeah.
Maria, a fantastic culmination to a fantastic season. You must be unbelievably happy to get the trophy.
For sure, I'm super happy. Consistency award, and that's what I wanted this year, to be on the top again.
Well, congratulations. Here
Thank
is
you.
Your trophy.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay, well done.
Well done, Mariana Pajon, the queen of BMX, a double Olympic champion, Olympic silver medalist, and World Cup winner.
Unbelievable. What a season she's had, with second place at the Olympic Games, just behind Britain's Bethany Schreiber.
Congratulations, well done, as she takes the overall for the Olympic women in 2021.
So final race, the men's elite competition. Now, the series title, well, if Simon Markar can score well here, he's got a very good chance of leapfrogging the Olympic bronze medalist Carlos Ramirez. Let's go through the introduction to the riders. Renaud Blanc of Switzerland in lane 8. Vincent Pelluar of Colombia riding the 120 plate. Cedric Bouty, also of Switzerland. And there he is. Simon Markar has had two victories so far this season. If he can make it another victory here today, or even place on the podium, he has a chance of winning the series title. There is Arthur Piard of France. And next to him, plate 33, Joris Daudet. Lives over in America, but very much part of this super strong French team. And they'll be fired up to compete at home in Paris in 3 years' time. Such competition for the French team. Eddie Clerté rode super fast in the semi-final. Yesterday's winner, Diego Arboleda. And he's got gate one. If Arboleda can get out in front, you've got to fancy Arboleda to take the win here today. The question is, what can Simon Marquardt do? Can he place high enough in this race to take the title?
Ready, watch the gate.
And they are off. The energy is high and it's all to play for.
Look at Marquardt coming hard, coming really fast into turn one. Marquardt has the lead. Marquardt has the lead over Arboleda. It's going to be neck and neck going into the second turn. But Simon Marquardt has a quick look over his shoulder and is able to push the Colombian wide on the second turn. Marquardt so strong, so powerful.
Simon Marquardt dominating this last straight. Can he hold on to it? The Colombian chasing him down, and he does it.
Simon Marquardt wins the race and confirms that he is the World Cup winner. Wow, Simon Marquardt, such power and such pressure on the young Swiss, but he delivered.
What a phenomenal result for Simon Marquardt. Such dominance throughout this series. We talk about consistency, and he's been in nigh on every finals. That is three World Cup victories in the same season.
Didn't have the best gate position, but look at him ride past Joris Daudet and all the way around the outside of Diego Arboleda, yesterday's winner. Simon Marquardt had such incredible power. Just superb. Well, Simon Marquardt, he won the opening race in Verona. Didn't go to Colombia, won here in Turkey the first weekend and has won again and has done enough, I think, once we've done all of the maths to take the series title.
Time to get the calculator out, Graham.
150 points for a win. He was 35 points behind. And the big, big news was when the leader, Carlos Ramirez, crashed in the semi-final.
Really leaving things wide open for Marquardt to seal the victory on the overall title.
So we're going to go for the post-race interviews now, as the crowd just move into position for the medal ceremony. We've got Joris Daudet.
Joris, a very tough race. Talk us through it from your perspective.
It was interesting. You know, the track was very technical and very challenging for all of us. So I think it made some interesting racing, and the last one didn't disappoint. So it was a good race for me. I had fun today, so I'm happy.
But for the final race of the series, you've got to be very happy with being on the podium once more.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, you know, the goal is always to be on the podium and be consistent for the championship. So I'm happy to be here tonight and looking forward for the next one.
Well, congratulations. Thank you very much.
Well done, Joris Daudet. Finishing the season off well with a podium placing. Of course, in Colombia, he was unstoppable, winning back to back in South America. The disappointing Olympics, crashed out in the final. He was on for a bronze medal in Tokyo.
Diego, a phenomenal performance and another podium. You've got to be a very happy man right now.
Yeah, I'm so happy. Good laps, good times, and yeah, really fun race.
What was it in particular that you did so well at today that got you on the podium once again?
The confidence. They've given me more confidence to stay in the gate and yeah, enjoy the lap and enjoy one lap at a time.
Well, congratulations. Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Well, Diego missed out on the two-man Colombian team to go to Tokyo. It was Vincent Pelluar and Ramirez. Ramirez went on to win the bronze medal in Tokyo. But Arboleda, well, he is going to be one to watch in the run-up towards Paris. But I think we've got now a chance to talk to the winner of today's race, Simon Marquardt.
Simon, I can tell that you're a very happy man. I saw the celebrations. Talk us through that final race to get you on the podium.
I had second gear pick, chose five. Just feel really comfortable there. Had a great start, great first straight. Got into the first turn first. Managed to stay first this time out of the first turn. And yeah, just brought it home.
And tell us just how happy are you, not only to be on the top of the podium, but to be the World Cup champion?
Yeah, that means a lot to me. It's only my third World Cup win, overall win. And probably most people don't know, but Liam Phillips, our coach, basically won everything now this season. So that was a big goal of us, to bring that World Cup overall home.
Well, congratulations. A phenomenal performance. Well done.
Thank you very much.
Simon Marquardt crediting Liam Phillips, the former BMX rider who is part of that coaching team out in Aigle at the World Cycling BMX Performance Centre in Switzerland. And yeah, to win everything, to win the Olympic Games with Nick Kiemann and to win the World Cup title with Marquardt as well. And actually, he's looking at the Tour de France. The Tour de France is starting in Aigle, one of their stages from Aigle to Châtel next summer. So that's a good excuse to go and visit the BMX racing and watch a bit of Tour de France as well at the same time. Might put that date in my diary.
Get a little bit of cycling in yourself, Graham.
Yeah.
Good fitness for the skiing and snowboarding.
That's great fitness for everything. Look at the winner there, Simon Marquardt. If you ever want to look at an athlete in his prime, Simon Marquardt taking the win.
Man,
congratulations.
Of the moment, just seeing his development throughout this series and sheer dominance.
And there is the confirmation of the standings. 740 points, that 150 point score to Simon Marquardt. Overtaking Carlos Ramirez, Joris Dode placing in third in the season standings. And congratulations, Simon Marquardt is the World Cup champion.
And what a feeling that must be after a long season, big season as well with the Olympic Games.
Well, if you've enjoyed the BMX racing over this year, we've had eight stops to the tour, then join us again next season for some more BMX action. But until then, it's goodbye from me, Graham Bell.
And me, Amy Fuller. Thank you for tuning in.
We're going to have a quick look at the highlights of today. But we'll see you again, hopefully, next season.